Tonight, on behalf of Harvard Bookstore, I am honored to introduce Alex Ross to discuss his second book, Listen to This. Listen to This showcases the best of Alex Ross and his writings from over a decade in The New Yorker. These 19 pieces glimmer with vibrant sketches of classical composers, high school music students in Newark, New Jersey, and researching Bob Dylan across a six-day, six-show stretch that took 3,000 miles off the life of a rental car. Reading Listen to This, I imagined Alex Ross on a stepladder, carefully handing me a bright container. I felt thrilled about learning about music again. Alex Ross has one previous book, The Rest is Noise, a cultural history of music in the 20th century, and a Pulitzer Prize finalist in 2008. Mr. Ross has been the New Yorker's music critic since 1996, and his writing is called nimble and imaginative, according to the Boston Globe. As a student of Harvard University, Ross studied under composer Peter Lieberson and moonlighted as a classical and underground rock DJ for the college radio station WHRB. Without further ado, ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Alex Ross.
Thank you so much to all of you for coming out. And I think, there might not be more seats up here. But it's a really delight to be back here at Harvard Bookstore, where I read from my book, The Rest is Noise, back in 2007. And it's just been an amazing experience to become an author and to have the very good luck of writing a book which has drawn a lot of notice, as The Rest of Noise did. And I just feel extraordinarily fortunate to have had such good support from my publisher, as well as from many, many bookstores around the country, as well as some fellow critics who spoke very kindly of my work. And I did go to college across the street, and actually had the wonderful experience of being back on the air at WHRB this afternoon for 5 hours, all 5 hours of afternoon concert. I was announcing it, and that was it felt very good to be back on the air there. And it was actually at WHRB that I started writing about music. We had some CD reviews in the program guide, and that sort of set me on the path, somewhat unconsciously at first, of becoming a music critic. It wasn't something that I dreamed of growing up from an early age to be a critic one day. I don't know how many children do, and if they do, I don't know if it would be a healthy thing. But nonetheless, I'm very glad with how it turned out for me, and I was able to combine my two great passions when I was young for writing and for music, and I think I was extraordinarily lucky that I was able to do both at once. The Rest is Noise was a rather sprawling history of 20th century music and really of the 20th century through its music. It took me many, many years to put together. I started writing it right at the end of the 20th century, and finally it saw print in 2007. And this new book, Listen to This, is a less ambitious endeavor. It is largely based on pieces that have appeared in The New Yorker, although some of them have been rewritten, and one of them is entirely new for this volume. But nonetheless, I did put a lot of heart into it, and it is a very personal book for me because it expresses how I discovered myself through music and discovered so much of the world through music, not only in classical music, but pop music as well. I thought I'd start by reading from the very beginning of the book, the first chapter, Listen to This. This is a piece that appeared in The New Yorker in 2004. I hate classical music, not the thing, but the name. It traps a tenaciously living art in a theme park of the past. It cancels out the possibility that music and the spirit of Beethoven could still be created today. It banishes into limbo the work of thousands of active composers who have to explain to otherwise well-informed people what it is they do for a living. The phrase is a masterpiece of negative publicity, a tour de force of anti-hype. I wish there were another name. I envy jazz people who speak simply of the music. Some jazz aficionados also call their art America's classical music, and I propose a trade. They can have classical, I'll take the music. For at least a century, the music has been captive to a cult of mediocre elitism that tries to manufacture self-esteem by clutching at empty formulas of intellectual superiority. Consider other names in circulation: art music, serious music, great music, good music. Yes, the music can be great and serious, but greatness and seriousness are not its defining characteristics. It can also be stupid, vulgar, and insane. Composers are artists, not etiquette columnists. They have the right to express any emotion, any state of mind. They have been betrayed by well-meaning acolytes who believe that the music should be marketed as a luxury good, one that replaces an inferior popular product. These guardians say, in effect, "The music you love is trash. Listen instead to our great arty music." They are making little headway with the unconverted because they have forgotten to define the music as something worth loving. Music is too personal a medium to support an absolute hierarchy of values. The best music is the music that persuades us that there is no other music in the world. When people hear classical, they think dead. The music is described in terms of its distance in the present, its difference from the mass. No wonder that stories of its imminent demise are commonplace. Newspapers recite a familiar litany of problems. Record companies are curtailing their classical divisions. Orchestras are facing deficits. The music is barely taught in public schools, almost invisible in the media, ignored or mocked by Hollywood. Yet the same story was told 40, 60, 80 years ago. Stereo Review wrote in 1969, "Fewer classical records are being sold because people are dying." Today's dying classical market is what it is because 15 years ago, no one attempted to instill a love for classical music in the then impressionable children who have today become the market. The conductor Alfred Wallenstein wrote in 1950, "The economic crisis confronting the American Symphony Orchestra is becoming increasingly acute." The German critic Hans-Heinz Stuckenschmidt wrote in 1926, "Concerts are poorly attended, and budget deficits grow from year to year." Laments over the decline or death of the art appear as far back as the 14th century, when the sensuous melodies of Ars Nova were thought to signal the end of civilization. The pianist Charles Rosen has sagely observed, "The death of classical music is perhaps its oldest continuing tradition." The American classical audience is assumed to be a moribund crowd of the old, the white, the rich, and the bored. Statistics provided by the National Endowment for the Arts suggest that the situation is not quite so dire. Yes, the audience is older than that for any other art. The median age is 49, but it is not the wealthiest. The parterre section at the Metropolitan Opera plays host to CEOs and socialites, but the less expensive parts of the house, as of this writing, most seats in the family circle at the Met go for $25, are well populated by schoolteachers, proofreaders, students, retirees, and others with no entry in the social register. If you want to see an in-your-face Swiss bank account display of wealth, go look at the millionaires sitting in the skyboxes at a Billy Joel show, if security lets you. As for the graying of the audience, there's no denying the general trend, although with any luck it may begin to level off. Paradoxically, even as the audience ages, the performers keep getting younger. The musicians of the Berlin Philharmonic are, on average, a generation younger than the Rolling Stones. The music is always dying, ever ending. It is like an ageless diva on a nonstop farewell tour coming around for one absolutely final appearance. It is hard to name because it never really existed to begin with, not in the sense that it stemmed from a single time or place. It has no genealogy, no ethnicity. Leading composers of today hail from China, Estonia, Argentina, Queens. The music is simply whatever composers create. a long string of written down works to which various performing traditions have become attached. It encompasses the high, the low, empire, underground, dance, prayer, silence, noise. Composers are genius parasites. They feed voraciously on the song matter of their time in order to engender something new. They have gone through a rough stretch in the past 100 years, facing external obstacles. Hitler and Stalin were amateur music critics, as well as problems of their own invention. Why doesn't anyone like our beautiful 12-tone music? But they may be on the verge of an improbable renaissance, and the music may take a form that no one today would recognize. So, I have a cough drop. Give me a second. I go on in the opening chapter of this book to give a little memoir of my upbringing as a listener. I began as someone purely, exclusively devoted to classical music and classical music of the Mozart to Brahms variety. I wasn't listening to any Ars Nova or 20th century music, for that matter. And this was a very full and emotionally rich world for me, which, of course, this music is. It does express every imaginable emotion. And I didn't really feel the need and didn't have the time or patience for anything else until I was well along in my teenage years, which, you know, didn't make me the most popular kid in high school, but, you know, this is just the way it was. And by the time I got to college and came here to Harvard, I was beginning to branch out, and I was becoming very interested in 20th century classical music. I tried to be a composer growing up, and that didn't lead anywhere, but I did really think very much about how music worked from the inside and read in music history and became fascinated in particular by the evolution of one style to another. And as you follow the evolution of styles, eventually you get into the modern period. And so on my show on WHRB, Music Since 1900, it was called, I went marching through the century decade by decade and made so many discoveries. And I think by my sophomore junior year, I was deep into the avant-garde of the post-war era, the very noisy and dissonant music of Cage and Stockhausen and Xenakis and Ligeti, music that is right on the border between the music and noise. And it was at this point that fellow DJs at the station started pointing out that they had music that was really constructed along very similar principles, music that was really just as noisy and unlistenable as the classical music that I was devoted to at the time. So, for example, if I was listening to Stockhausen's Gruppen, there we go. They would say, "Well, why don't you listen to some Cecil Taylor?" Or some Per Ubu. And it was at this point that my resistance to popular music, or unpopular music in this case, really broke down. And I gave up on the assumption that I talk about at the beginning of the essay, Listen to This, that classical music was the only true province of serious and difficult musical thought. I realized that there was so much more that I had yet to know. And so I started discovering popular music, and it's a process that's ongoing for me. There still is so much that that I haven't heard or haven't really sat down and tried to understand. But it was just a great joy for me to cross the border from one genre to another in that way. And what I also realized was that people my own age who had grown up with pop music and had not been exposed to classical music could cross that border moving in the opposite direction. And as they proselytized to me and sort of urged me to listen to their favorite music, pointing out the common ground with what I was already interested in, I did the same and started proselytizing for my favorite 20th century composers. And a number of my friends really started to become excited about Steve Reich or John Adams or Ligeti or Messiaen. And it was the germ of an idea that I've pursued, I think, all through my writing in The New Yorker and also in the book The Rest is Noise, to show how this music that does seem esoteric at first encounter actually has manifold links with the musical cultures outside of it, with culture in general, and with the whole stream of 20th century history as well. So I think I was sort of already at that stage moving toward the idea of writing The Rest is Noise, which was also really present, in very embryonic form in the radio show that I was doing. So it's been almost a lifelong project for me to show these connections in our bigger musical culture. And the funny thing is, it's rare to find classical music and popular music discussed between the covers of a single book. There are some outstanding examples that bring to mind. One is Wilfred Meller's fantastic book, Music in a New Found Land, which I believe, unfortunately, has gone out of print. It certainly deserves to be in print. An attempt by a British writer to understand American music through really all its manifestations, from composed, from starting with folk music really, and then composed classical music, and then the blues and jazz and a bit of rock and roll toward the end. But it's quite rare to find a book that looks at music across such a wide canvas. I also think of John Rockwell, who covered both classical music and pop music for the New York Times for many years. And so it was a project that I decided I wanted to take up as well when I started writing first for the New York Times and then for the New Yorker. And I'm really not sure I was all that successful at it, particularly when it came to writing just a sort of a straightforward review of a rock show, and I did this a few times when I was at the Times. I really found it very difficult. I lacked the language to really take it on, and I also lacked the knowledge, the reference points that anyone who listened to this music seriously all their lives will instantly have to hand. I just didn't have that sort of foundation of knowledge, but nonetheless, I'm happy that I made the attempt, and some of the pieces I felt were better than others, and perhaps worth preserving. So I put those in this book, and there are a few shorter pieces, a memorial for Kurt Cobain, the piece on Sonic Youth, and three longer pieces on Björk, Radiohead, and Bob Dylan. And I think the pieces on Björk and Radiohead were came to me more naturally, because these are artists who are very aware of classical music and know quite a bit about it. Björk trained seriously as a flutist and also as a composer to some extent. And she possesses a really pretty deep knowledge of the 20th century classical repertory. So that was a natural talking point that I had with her when I started to interview her. And her whole music is somewhere between the popular world and the classical world, and exists in a category very much of its own. Otherwise, I have a series of essays in this book on canonical classical composers: Mozart, Schubert, Verdi, and Brahms. I have profiles of musicians such as Esa-Pekka Salonen and Mitsuko Uchida, seen within the context of Marlboro music, the fantastic festival and music camp up in Vermont. Profile of the Alaska-based composer John Luther Adams, pieces on music education, following the St. Lawrence String Quartet, a young, at the time, quartet on the road. It's really trying to look at musical life from many different angles and build up a composite picture. The final thing I'd like to do before answering your questions is talk a bit about the second chapter of the book, which is the new piece, the one I wrote for Listen to This, and it's called Ciccone Lamento Walking Blues. And the idea of this piece is again to trace connections between genres, among genres, and across a pretty wide span of musical history. And in fact, the foolish ambition that I had was to write a history of music in about 10,000 words from the medieval period to the present, but through the lens, a very restricted lens, of a few very specific motifs, and two or three musical ideas that I follow across that big musical expanse. One is the form known as the Ciccone, which was a very lively and rollicking dance which cropped up in Spanish-speaking countries, apparently originally in South America, at the end of the 16th century. It may have sounded something like this. And skip ahead 100 years and you find that the Ciccone has undergone a dramatic, almost inexplicable transformation. And in the hands of Johann Sebastian Bach, it now sounds like this. And another motif that I follow is one that I call, and many over the centuries before me have called, lamento, a falling sequence of notes that very often seems to signify lament. And in its basic form on the piano, it sounds like this. Now, this idea of a downward sliding pattern connected to lament is something that you find in many different musical cultures across the world. I'll play a few examples from Eastern Europe. Here's a bocet, or lament, from Romania. Here's one from Hungary. Now, in a famous Renaissance chanson by Johannes Ockeghem, dating from around 1460, you find that same downward trudging series of four notes. This is four sul mol. And here it is in John Dolan's Elizabethan song, Flow My Tears. Now, there's a very interesting moment when Claudio Monteverdi, the great Italian composer of the end of the 16th century, early 17th century, takes that falling motif and turns it into this steadily, hypnotically repeating pattern, an ostinato, which is Italian for obstinate. And this is a principle that derives from the dance music of the time, where you found these ostinatos constantly churning in the bass lines of dances. But Monteverdi takes a repetition, which often had a happy, a liberating connotation, and makes it a symbol of sadness, of lament, in his Lamento della Ninfa. Oops. I can find a lot more examples from the Baroque era, but I thought I'd skip ahead another couple of hundred years, and you find really the exact same bass line in Ray Charles. Not a lament exactly, but it does signify a certain distress and dismay in matters of love. There's a variant form of this lament figure, which is the chromatic form. Think of consecutive notes on the piano keyboard, black and white keys. And this descending figure was again used as an ostinato. It's a practice which began in the Baroque period. It figures very memorably in the Crucifixus of Bach's B minor Mass, where it symbolizes the sufferings of Christ on the cross. And you also hear it at the end of the first movement of Beethoven's Ninth Symphony. Now, there's dozens more examples you can find from the classical literature. The leap that I try to make at the end of this chapter is outside of the classical arena and into popular music, and specifically into the land of the blues. And in Mississippi Delta blues especially, you keep hearing this descending chromatic figure, not quite the same as the one I played before, but it seems to have this same downward pull of lament attached to it. This is Willie Brown's Future Blues. Of course, these blues figures had a lasting effect on so much of the pop music and rock music that followed. Here's the beginning of one of Led Zeppelin's epic live versions of Dazed and Confused. That bass line is really overwhelming my pathetic little speakers that I brought along. And what most fascinated me was the fact that in the 1960s and 70s, you start hearing a specific form of this chromatic descent used in that ostinato fashion over and over again in the bass line of a song. It suddenly starts happening around 1964 and 1965 in the Beatles, in Bob Dylan, in a lot of other music from that period. And I'll play a classic example, which is a later song of Dylan, A Simple Twist of Fate from Blood on the Tracks.
A saxophone someplace far off played as she was walking on by the arcade, as the light bust through a beat-up shade where he was waking up. She dropped a coin into the cup of a blind man at the gate and forgot about a simple twist of fate.
Now, one thing I really enjoyed doing in putting this book together is having set out these themes of Chicona and lament in the second chapter, I inserted references to them in many of the other essays throughout the book. And it's not at all an artificial thing to do, since the motif is so common and it was often used with such a specific expressive point by composers across the ages. Mozart uses it at the beginning of Don Giovanni in the overture. Schubert uses it in the first movement of his final string quartet, the quartet in G, where it is like this chromatic shadow falling over an ostensibly warm and happy major key landscape. Brahms used it very pointedly in a number of pieces, and he also revived the chaconne form at a moment when it really seemed to have died out in musical history. There's this tremendous dark chaconne at the end of his fourth symphony. And yes, when I come to Bob Dylan at the end of the book, I inserted a little more material in the essay to make the point that this bass line in the song Simple Twist of Fate does point back centuries in musical history. And there's a specific and rather eerie resemblance to Dido's lament, the great lament that Dido, Queen of Carthage, sings at the end of Henry Purcell's opera, Dido and Aeneas. I have no idea whether Bob Dylan knows this music, but the fact is you have another song here about fate, and even about the idea of forgetting fate. And so this is Lorraine Hunt Lieberson singing the end of Dido's lament. Thank you. Well, I have, of course, his complete the collected poems, and also the Library of America edition of Stevens. But the little paperback that I have right on my desk is the collection, The Palm at the End of the Mind, which actually I bought in Harvard Bookstore in 1990. It was the first Stevens that I read, and it had an enormous effect on me. And he does remain my favorite poet and a constant inspiration, although of course a model that I couldn't possibly hope to match. But I pick up Wallace Stevens and I look at his language and words jump out at me, and it seems to enliven my own vocabulary and sort of push me out of routines and cliches that I might have fallen into. So it really is my verbal Bible in a way. I think it's very complicated. You know, it's not a question of a sort of intellectual understanding or an analytic understanding. Although, of course, that can be a very useful project to undertake. And I read analyses of music, and I've sort of tried to do them myself on occasion. Although I lack the full academic training to do so, but I think I really mean something else when I say understanding in this context, which is, I think, feeling at home in a piece of music, knowing its contours well enough that you can almost walk through them blindfolded, if that's not too convoluted a metaphor to apply to a listening experience. But it's that sense that after a number of listenings, and it may happen almost right away, or it may take years until you achieve that sense of familiarity, then yes, the music really does belong to you in some sense, and that you feel, I don't know, it's difficult to put into words, but I sort of know what it what it feels like from my point of view in my own history as a listener, and once I have achieved that sort of rougher sense of understanding, it's always something that I try to guide others toward in my writing. And I often say, you know, if you don't understand a piece or an entire genre, you know, just simply listening again and then a third time and a fourth time is the way you may begin to change your perspective on it. And it may never happen. You know, there are pieces, there are, you know, even, you know, entire genres that remain closed to me or to others, and that moment of transformation may never occur. But it's an unpredictable process, and I always find it really can happen out of the blue. You know, once you have made this sort of unknown number of attempts to really get to know a piece of music, and I think it does also help to read about a composer or an artist and to understand what is going on around them, and, you know, where they come from biographically and socially and culturally and historically. And you know, although all that information may ultimately be on the outside of this sort of much more inward process that happens when we're listening deeply to music, I think it can sort of push you over the edge in some mysterious way toward that deeper understanding. Yeah, that's an interesting question, and it is sort of always oscillating for me, and I've sort of experienced my sort of ups and downs with composers over the years to a degree that I'm actually I'm a little skeptical now. I think you know, both of my enthusiasms and also of my apparent rejection of a particular kind of music, because I know it can fluctuate, and it's sort of like a personal relationship. So I feel my my sense of these composers and artists is always changing. I think there was a time when I and I really don't mean to offend any Brucknerians in the audience, but when I was a kid, I absolutely loved Bruckner, or I sort of loved the sound that the Bruckner made, the kind of, you know, sort of monumental aspect of it. The very first LP that I bought when I was 10 years old, actually, was Bruckner's Ninth Symphony, which I feel like I should have been institutionalized or undergone therapy for listening to Bruckner at so young an age. But and it sort of remained a passion of mine through my college years, and it's subsided as of now. It's not that I dislike Bruckner. I respect the composer, but it doesn't seem to call out to me that I feel this sudden craving in the middle of the night to hear Bruckner. But I know, I mean, 10 years from now, I may be head over heels and in love with Bruckner again. I don't know. It's mysterious, and you know, this sort of examples in pop music as well. Never in my whole life have I really felt what so many other people feel for the Rolling Stones, for example. But I think that may have been a symptom of just having come to rock music much too late to experience a sort of primal connection with the Rolling Stones that a lot of people felt at an earlier age. But you know, there's still time for me to wake. Maybe I'll pick up the Keith Richards memoir, and that'll do it for me. I don't know. Well, I have something much better than a CD, which is I have on my website, therestisnoise.com, I have hundreds of musical examples to go along with each chapter of the book. Instead of, you know, you get 75 minutes on a CD if it were included in the book, whereas, you know, here I have, I don't know how many hours, I mean, many, many hours of music, as well as links to websites where you can hear a lot more of the music. And I think this is actually a better way of doing it, because, I mean, of course, you need a, you know, viable internet connection, but it allows you to it just gives me a lot more latitude in just presenting, you know, just so many different examples that people can turn to as they're reading. And, you know, frankly, the getting the rights for a CD to a lot of this music would be very difficult. It's a lot easier to obtain rights to have a streaming, non-downloadable, audio sample on the internet for whatever reason. It's easier. Oh, well, I have a couple paragraphs in Sinatra in this book. I wrote about him when he died. The New Yorker asked a number of critics and contributors to the magazine to offer their thoughts about Sinatra. So I contributed a few of my own, and then I've added a little bit to it for this book. I love Sinatra. I mean, he's not someone I grew up with at all. I forget exactly what age, but sort of sometime, you know, well into my 20s that I started listening to him, and it's sort of my appreciation for the power of his voice and the meticulousness, the nuance that he brought to the recitation of lyrics. It just grows and grows. I mean, it's just a magnificent instrument in conjunction with the arrangements. You know, and he had such a fabulous taste in arrangers, the people that he worked with, Nelson Riddle and Gordon Jenkins, and those arrangements just sound better and better with the passage of time. And just to throw in a little bit more audio here, I'll play a little bit from the end of Angel Eyes, and I mentioned Sinatra in this chapter on lament in the book, because I feel that Sinatra seemed to be drawn especially to songs that had these sliding chromatic elements to them, and so you do hear this in the bass in Angel Eyes.
Pardon me, but I gotta run. The facts uncommonly clear.
Well, I can't fade it down. We have to hear the rest.
Excuse me while I disappear.
So that's my comment on Sinatra. Sure, yeah. I mean, well, first of all, this book is made up of longer pieces, and you know, very often when I decide to write a longer piece, where I spend weeks or even months doing the research, getting to know an artist to write a profile or studying up on a composer of the past, it does really need to come from passion and enthusiasm and a sort of a deep-seated positive feeling about the figure in question. I just can't imagine spending that much time on someone I don't like. And you know, of course, in my shorter pieces and in my columns for The New Yorker, I do sometimes go negative. You know, when I feel that it's deserved. It's not my favorite aspect of being a critic, because I feel I only have so much time and only so much space, and I might as well devote it to music that I admire as much as possible. And you know, frankly, if I criticize some well-known singer or a pianist, it usually has no effect whatsoever. You know, they'll go on doing what they're doing. But if there's a lesser known, a rising artist whom I do admire, this is an area where I can really have an impact and change something a little bit by drawing attention to him or her. So I do really enjoy that aspect of my job. And in terms of right now, what is sort of catching my attention, it's hard to say. I mean, there's a tremendous amount going on in the classical world right now. There's a lot of younger composers who are very, very alive and energetic and really want to shake up the definition of what it means to be a composer and engaging with popular music or sort of a lot of music sort of outside of what a composer is ordinarily expected to deal with. So this is actually in New York, there's really a thriving scene right now of such younger composers, specifically in Brooklyn. So I've been following them a great deal. I think, you know, the other very active and lively sort of subculture of classical music is early music. I think, you know, especially in Baroque performance, there is so much freedom now, so much more freedom than there was a few decades ago. People are really rediscovering improvisation and taking the score not as an exact blueprint, something to be reproduced note for note, but as a really as a set of suggestions and filling in the rest with playing that comes directly from their own personalities. And this is how music was played in the Baroque era. There was a great deal of spontaneity and improvisation. So I find that very encouraging, and it's a joy to go to a concert where people are engaging with the music on that level. I've just been listening to it's a wonderful CD. I just put it on my blog yesterday, recommending it very strongly, called Flights of Fantasy, early Italian Baroque chamber music. Monica Huggett is leading the Irish Baroque Orchestra, members of the Irish Baroque Orchestra, and it's just a joy from beginning to end. There really is such freedom in the playing. We don't really know if this is how the music sounded back then, but it sounds very alive right in the present moment, which maybe counts even more. Yes, certainly. I mean, I mentioned Wolfred Mellers, and he's he's been a strong example for me for many years. The sort of historical critics, I mean, George Bernard Shaw and Virgil Thompson, Andrew Porter, my august predecessor at the New Yorker, is certainly an intimidating example for me because his knowledge is so vast. You know, I also read pop music critics, and I find their approach very refreshing and provocative because you get a lot more social commentary, political commentary in pop music criticism, really addressing serious and pressing issues that a lot of classical critics will shy away from, politics, race, sexuality, and so I often look to them really as a signal to be more bold as far as possible in my own writing. And of course I have to cite extraordinary and provocative musicologist Richard Cheruskin, who is a scholar who has also great journalistic flair, which is an unusual combination to find. And you know, from the time I first started out as a critic, I was reading the pieces that he wrote for the New Republic and the New York Times, and they were a great inspiration to me, with the sense that you could take a journalistic piece and really get in very deep in a given subject and get into some very complex issues. But if you did it with sufficient, I think, verve and energy and style, you can bring people along. So that is what Richard Cheruskin does, you know, whether you agree with him or not, and often I don't, but he is just tremendously exciting to engage with as a reader. Well, in a way, I wrote an entire book on this question in the form of The Rest is Noise, where, you know, I tried to grapple with that issue and then transcend it just by trying to point out to people the many, many ways in which this music did matter very directly in the culture and history of its time, and also suggesting the ways in which as a listener you can really engage with it, not just intellectually but emotionally. But it remains a sort of an unanswered question for me to a great extent. You know, I've read sort of studies by neuroscientists and others who attempt to determine, well, you know, is there a certain kind of music that sort of fundamentally is more agreeable to the human species than others? You know, are we sort of hardwired to prefer tonality to atonality? But, you know, the problem with that kind of study is that, you know, even if you're working with a group of infants or however they conduct these studies, you know, playing Schoenberg to 3-month-old babies, I'm not quite sure how it's done. You know, they're already, even at that age, infants have already been probably, you know, surrounded by tonal music, and it will already sound natural to them. So I'm not entirely convinced, even if the results do seem to show some kind of natural preference to tonality over atonality. You know, I think, you know, every kind of music is an acquired taste. I don't think we're born loving any kind of music, and there's no music that's universally popular. You know, I mean, the most popular of popular artists are still a minority taste. I was reading a blogger who goes by the name of Proper Discord, who pointed out that the top selling artist in America in a given week, I forget who it was, maybe it was Lady Gaga or someone, the record had been bought by 1 in 1,600 Americans. So, you know, this was something that the average person on the street probably wasn't listening to, and yet it was whoever it was the most popular artist in America at that moment. So the point is, I think, you know, in terms of our, you know, falling in love with any given kind of music, someone somewhere along the way has guided us toward it and sort of brought us into it. And, you know, the problem with the 20th century classical music is that we've lacked so many of those guides. I mean, if you compare the situation with modern art, and there are studies that show that infants and sort of young people prefer representational art to abstract art. It's just you know, they're sort of naturally drawn to the basic representational version of making a picture. But then, you know, at some very early age as well, they've been taken to a museum. They see the Rothkos, they see the Picassos and Kandinskys on the wall, and you know, they may not fall in love with the painting right at that moment, but, you know, a seed is planted, and later in adulthood they come to appreciate that painting, or at least respect it and view it as valid, you know, a valid artistic statement. And this just hasn't happened with 20th century music for so many people at that age or any age, you know. And if you just consider all the work that went into the propagation of modern art, you know, the patrons, the critics writing about it, you know, the Museum of Modern Art and the, you know, Art Institute of Chicago and so on and so forth, you know, is working actively to persuade people of the value of this music. The same thing was not going on at symphony orchestras and opera houses in almost everywhere for almost the entirety of the 20th century, with some, you know, sporadic exceptions. But, you know, for the most part, people weren't arguing for that music. So I feel that is really as close as possible to the root of it. Not a physiological explanation, not a sort of a psychological one or even a cultural one, but just the lack of good propaganda, frankly, and I think it has begun to change, you know, and I think there is more acceptance for even the more adventurous varieties of 20th century music than there was, you know, even 20 years ago when I started out as a critic. But I'm sort of ranting a little bit on this topic, sorry. No, I think you're right, and there is that sense that that it's just a mysterious and opaque and impenetrable world for so many people, and they don't mind it. And, you know, if Mozart is playing in their dentist's waiting room, they may find it perfectly agreeable, but they're not going to make the effort to go to a concert. They don't feel the need for it, and if they did try to go, they really might find the experience mystifying and unsatisfying on some level. And I think this is something that the classical world does need to address to some extent, because I feel that that some of our more mainstream institutions have fallen into routines that have really barely changed for 100 years. These little rituals that have become attached to classical music, which are pretty harmless in themselves, but I think cumulatively give the appearance of an art that is frozen in time. And, you know, this is why I love these, you know, the sort of Baroque performances, you know, Renaissance and Baroque performances. You know, another splendid example is the Jordi Savall. That was Jordi Savall and his Hesperian 21 ensemble playing the Chacona, the Spanish Chacona that I demonstrated. And it's such a wonderfully alive and vibrant performance. It just, you don't even think about it. Is this classical music or is it popular music? I mean, who knows? It is what it is. And so just a little more of that vibrancy somehow would be very welcome in, I think, symphony orchestra concerts in particular. And, you know, how exactly that would be done is a difficult question, you know, and there's all kinds of ways in which you could make very bad mistakes and you know, ruin the experience with sort of cloying and condescending moves that, you know, aim to attract, you know, younger audiences that, you know, aren't going to show up anyway, and just sort of, you know, satisfies someone's sense of, well, we just need to try something. I mean, it needs to be organic, you know, and it needs to have artistic value. But I think it has to start with the performers. And I think in our conservatories, teachers and their students really should be thinking on a deeper level about, well, why are we doing this? I mean, we're not thinking of themselves simply as executants of this ancient tradition, but, you know, in a contemporary context, you know, why are we playing this music? And if people aren't getting it, you know, how can we bring it to life for them? And I think, you know, that's, they have to provide the answer. I mean, critics and everyone else can sort of talk and talk and talk, but, you know, ultimately, the answer has to come from them. Let me get inside the mind of Mozart for a second. No, I mean, it's fascinating. Or Wagner, you know, I think it's even more fascinating as to kind of, well, what would Wagner, what would he be doing? And you know, where should we go hide and duck while he perpetrates whatever it is that he's about to do? I mean, but, you know, then, I mean, when you say the name Wagner, what I mean to think of is just the audacity, the wild ambition that Wagner showed. And it's not even a question of what genre, what medium are you going to apply yourself to, but simply that mad sense of daring and this urge to do something that everyone at the time declared to be impossible, you know, and he went ahead and did it anyway. And Mozart, frankly, did the same thing with Don Giovanni, which was a daring and dangerous piece in a lot of ways. And he was combining genres in his day and sort of blending the boundary between what was an aria and what was an instrumental solo and what was a symphony and what was an opera. So I think that kind of non-impolite, against the grain kind of thinking is really what we need. So yeah, I would like to see more mad ambition in today's younger composers. I think that might be all that we have time for. But thank you all so much, and I'd be happy to sign books, of course.